Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. To what God's word has to say, let the church say amen. Hallelujah. Stand to your feet. It's time for the word of God. And it's time to hear what God has to say to us. We are wearing white because he is risen. I've been to the tomb in Israel and I have good news for you. Jesus is alive. The tomb is empty because Jesus rose from the dead and he conquered the grave. And because of his great accomplishment, we are standing here today. Can I have a shout of praise? And because he's alive, he's here in this room. Why don't you lift your hands right before we receive the word? And let's welcome the presence of God here. Where are you, Lord? Where can I find you? Everybody lift your hands, lift your voice. Let's sing. You must be in this room. Right by my side.
Right by my side.
Now lift your hands. Tell him, I want to feel you.
I want to feel.
Close your eyes. Forget about everyone else. And tell him, I want to believe.
I want to believe.
What an encounter we are in for today. Experience. Experience your mighty presence
with me.
Let's sing it again. Where are you, Lord?
And where are you, Lord?
Where can I find you?
Where can I find you?
You must be in this room.
You must be in this
room. I can't see you, Jesus, but I believe in you.
Right by my side.
How many of you need him?
And I wanna feel you.
I want to believe.
I wanna believe.
I wanna experience.
Experience your mighty presence with me.
The Lord is here.
The Lord thy God in the midst of thee. He is a mighty God. He will save.
Side.
Right by my side.
Come on, church, lift your voice and sing it. Your prayer. Oh, he can hear you in heaven. That's what I need. Close your eyes, lift your hands and sing to him. Every place, Jesus. Every place. I want to feel the presence of God
standing right by me,
standing
right by my side. Oh, such power,
such a presence.
Such
lift
a
your hands,
presence.
Welcome his presence.
Everywhere I go.
This is my favorite part. If you don't go with me,
not go with me,
then I don't want to go.
I don't want to go there.
I don't want to have anything.
I don't want to have anything where you are.
The Lord thy God.
The Lord thy God in the midst of thee. He is a man. Say he will rejoice over thee with joy. God in the midst of thee, he will rest in his love. He will joy
every place that I want to feel the presence of God standing right. One more time. Stand right by my side.
Right by my side. You are here, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
That is what I need. Everywhere that I go, every place that I am,
I want to feel the presence of God. Standing right by me.
Father, thank you for this time. What an amazing blessing to be here on this special Easter Sunday. We are grateful. Holy Spirit, speak to us, comfort us, and guide us. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. What a blessing to be here on Easter Sunday. This morning, I want to just share with you, because just a short message today, on the grave is not the end. The grave is not the end. Amen. The grave is not the end. That's the reality of resurrection. And I want us to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 12. It says, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? All right? Now, all the way to the very end of the chapter, verse 55 says, O death, where is thy sting? And O grave, where is thy victory? All right? Now, death has a sting, and grave has a feeling of, it has won over life. All right? That's the effect of death. And the grave. The grave seems to have overcome human beings. No matter who you are, what you are, what you do, and how important the things you are doing are, the grave seems to neutralize you and shut you up. And death has a sting. There's a feeling that comes with death. Of anybody, even people that are far away from you, the feeling of death, there's a feeling, it's a negative feeling, very negative. And so the Bible says, death, where is your sting? And grave, where is your victory? So I believe that the resurrection is one of the very important subjects, and the fact that the grave is not the end. Amen. Now, this world existed before we came on the scene, and our history is from Genesis, which is just 5,000, 6,000 years ago. But everyone knows that the earth is far older than that. And everyone knows that animals and other skeletons and so on have been found, which are far older than the 5,000, 6,000 years. And you must know that these scientific things are true, because when they see a star and they say this star is 1,000 light years away, or Mars, for instance, is so far, What happens is that they do a calculation, and Mars is like a star. If you can see, how many have seen Mars before? It's a planet in the sky. If you know how to notice the planets, anytime I'm outside with people and we see planets, I show. But Mars has a time that it comes. You see, it's reddish, and this is just like a star. But there's a calculation. They say it is this distance, and then they make a rocket. Do you see? And they give it speed, fuel, time, everything, and they send it, and it gets there. And when they get there, they film it and they land. So all these calculations are true, including the age of animals, the age of skeletons, all these scientific things. They are not just theories. They are real things that have been proved, especially by going to places like Mars, going to Mercury, going to the sun, and all that. They've been proved to be true. They are real. They say this is the distance to the sun, so many million miles, and it is found to be true. Okay? So we started our history from Adam's time, and from Adam all the way up to Noah, all right? Because Noah came on the scene not so long after Adam died, because Adam lived to be almost 1,000 years, and then Noah came on, just there was a little gap, and then Noah was born, and Noah lived. And then the history of man is known, everybody knows it. So Adam had an experience in the garden through his disobedience, and we must all fear disobedience. And in that, he was punished, and he said, "You are going to die." This is so. It's death. We were not really intended to die, and you can see how empty the earth is. I was just in the north, and we can drive for a long time. There's nobody. Space, a lot of space, a lot of people, space, this land, the whole country is empty of people. Although there are a lot of people still in the world, but there's a lot of space everywhere. So we were supposed to have been living and adding on. Like by now, we would have said, so we are going to visit Adam. You get what I'm saying? And we're visiting Adam, asking Abraham, all those guys will still be on earth. Do you see? Everybody would have been flowing normally on earth, and the conflicts and the things we've been having, we wouldn't be having. No one would have died. We'd have lived forever. In fact, that's why God sacked Adam and Eve, because they didn't want them to eat of the tree of life and not die. Do you see? Because if certain people live too long, it's going to cause problems. So if you see like Hitler and Stalin and some other wild people, it's sometimes like death is almost like a blessing that they are not alive. Like you can't get up and see this person again because he's gone. You get it? Only that they have other people that come with the same spirit. So death has been destroying our lives for years. Amen. And death spoils everything. Death spoils everything. My son, David, just passed away. It spoils everything. You ask me, am I sad? If you had a son who died, would you be sad? You should ask yourself that question. It spoils everything. It brings a feeling, a funny environment, and it makes nonsense of everything. We always try to wish it further and further away, but that's how it is, you know? And so God has promised us that there would be a resurrection, like an overcoming of the greatest problem that has been introduced to human beings, like which is death, that you have to die. You have to leave everything you are doing and go out of this world. No matter how good you are. I was surprised to read that Paul was only about 58 years old when he died. Apostle Paul. Oh, yes. Yes. And he went out. You know, so it's like You know, one time I was in the UK and somebody took me to a golf course and told me this is where James Bond plays. Do you know James Bond? Roger Moore. Yeah, he said, well, this is where Roger Moore plays golf. I said, wow. So we were walking around. It's two huge golf courses joined together. So I said, who owns this place? He said, Japanese man, one man. Can you imagine the land in the UK? Two huge golf courses. And I realized that even if this Japanese man wants to hold one of the trees in the golf course and say, I will not go, he will go. And it will make nonsense of everything he has. Are you with me? Yes. That's what death does. It make you can acquire and heap up. But at a point, even the things you've heaped up start to fight you. I remember my father-in-law before he died, one of the things he said, it's not good to have too many houses. I was surprised to hear him say that. But he's an experienced man with a lot of houses. So, death comes to spoil like all your education, your family. It's a very severe punishment. Apart from the punishment of the work, like now you suffer to work. Then after that too, you will also die. It's a wild neutralizer. How many agree with me that death is a wild neutralizer of our happiness and of our existence? And even if you've not been sentenced to death, and even if you don't have a disease which you know of which I am going to die, do you see? You are still sentenced to death. One day, I was watching a documentary about a man who was sentenced to death and was about to be executed. In fact, he was executed. So the priest went in with him and spoke with him for the last, they had the last meal and all that. And so when he came out, they asked him two questions. Did the man admit the thing that they said he did? They said, no, he said he did not admit it. He said he didn't do it. And then, so they asked him, what did you tell him before he died? He told the man, he said he told the man that, look, you have been sentenced to death. And he said that the rest of us have also been sentenced to death, only that we don't know the date. That's also what he told the man. And it's true. We are all under that sentence. Every day we wake up, we are one day nearer the day that that sentence will be executed. So when Jesus came to this world, all right, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Wow. Jesus is the resurrection. I am the resurrection and the life. I am resurrection. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Wow. So Jesus promised that he was the resurrection. And that is the difference between a believer and a non-believer, is our faith in the resurrection. That's what makes the difference. Now, it makes a difference in two ways. It makes a difference at the funeral. You know, one time I was actually involved in the funeral of somebody who didn't believe in God. So I had to speak, because certain persons, what do you call it? But the person didn't believe in God, and the family also didn't believe in God. I tell you, I was out of words. Can you imagine me out of what to say? Do you know what I did? I checked the internet. What do you say at a funeral when somebody doesn't believe in God? I Googled it and I saw something. What should I say? Because they don't believe all these things you are saying. And apparently the priests in England are always officiating funerals of people who don't believe in God. Because even though they don't believe in God, when they die, they call the priest. So it's a common thing to officiate funerals of people who don't believe in God. So what do you say? Because when you say, I'm the resurrection, also, what is all this? Now? When you are dead like a dog. Your meat is just nothing. That is all they believe. But we believe that we shall rise again. Amen. Jesus was asking Martha, do you believe he will rise again in the resurrection? Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12. Beautiful. Now, if Christ be risen, it says in verse 13, if there's no resurrection, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is also useless. If there's nothing like resurrection, what we believe is useless. Yea, and we have found false witnesses because we've testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he didn't raise. Verse 16. If the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, then your faith is in vain, and you are yet in your sins. So if Christ is not raised, it means that Jesus is not Lord of Lords. He didn't overcome death. He didn't rise from the dead as he said. He said, I'll rise after 3 days. If that's not the case, then we are seriously in trouble in our faith. Are you with me? We are in serious difficulty. So we believe that Christ is raised. Amen. Now, if Christ is not raised, verse 18 says, then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. That means that anybody who has died and fallen asleep has perished. But that is not and cannot be the case. In our church today, we have a number of members who are not on this earth, who have died. So we have members on earth and members in heaven. Amen. We have a branch in heaven, actually. Amen. How many want to join that branch? Not now. You'll be joining later. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, then we are of all men most miserable. Why? Why are we of all men most miserable? Because there are so many things that we could have done in this world that we didn't do because of Christ. Such as what? Can you mention 3 things that you would have done? Huh? Good or bad? Either good or bad. Polygamy. You'd have married a number of wives. Okay. Fornication, isn't it? Freely you'll be fornicated. What else? Drinking. Alcohol has an effect. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes that alcohol makes you merry. It does what? It makes you merry. The scripture that says that, and money answers all things. And money answers all things. That's the scripture. Oh, yes. Find that scripture quickly. 10:19. A feast is made for laughter. And wine makes you happy. Huh? So I don't know how happy you are. But it looks like you would have been very happy if you could have some. You forget about all your troubles. I mean, it's in the Bible. But because of Christ, isn't it? You are forsaking your whiskey, your gin, your wine, your beer, Your vodka. And what else? Wow. You've forsaken those who wanted to marry many, you couldn't marry. Those who wanted to just fornicate around, just anybody you see, Charlie, let's fornicate. Let's fornicate for this weekend. What else have you forsaken? Stealing money and doing anything to get money. Yes. Killing people. Fighting. Doing what you feel like doing. What about smoking? And getting high. I'll take you high. What else have you forsaken? Secular music. What? Jay-Z. Jay-Z. I don't know what that is. Secular music, you have forsaken it. And what else have you forsaken? Pornography. You'd have been enjoying all types of pornography. Japanese pornography, Haitian pornography, Congolese pornography, Nigerian pornography, different types. Shorter ones, long ones, all types. Wow. What else have you forsaken? Betting, gambling. You'd have been gambling freely. Multiple husbands. If one husband is not satisfied, you can have three or four. One for money, one for sex, one for fellowship, and one for holiday. You are forsaken for Christ's sake. What else have you forsaken? Clubbing. Clubbing. In nightclubs. You'd have been grooving, dancing, smooching. Wow. So do you miss it a lot? See me after church. Those of you who lifted your hands. You people, Christ is listening to you. He's listening to you and wondering to himself, has he made you suffer so much? How many are sorry? Tell him that you are sorry. You are sorry, Lord. He said, if in this life only we have hope, we are of all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits. He's the first example of someone who rises from the dead. All right? So notice, as in Adam, all men die. Notice the scripture. As in Adam, verse 22, all men die. So in Christ shall all men be made alive. So all our brethren who are gone, we are going to see them again. And I believe I'm going to see my son again. He's going to be made alive. Amen. One day. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank God. Now verse 25 says, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. Verse 26, the last enemy. The what? The last enemy of our lives that will be destroyed is death. Death is an enemy to everything you are doing. I'm telling you. You know, as I'm building the church, God has shown me that, look, you can't be here forever. form a council, appoint a chairman, and leave them to the Holy Spirit. I said, what? He said, yes, form a council, appoint a chairman, and leave them to the Holy Spirit. And he showed me that's what he did. He formed a council of 12 apostles, appointed Peter as a chairman, and left them to the Holy Spirit. Take over. Yes. So our churches and denominations are being run and being run by councils with a chairman. They have a chairman for each one. And we're leaving them to the Holy Spirit, because whatever we are doing, we can only help. I mean, have you wondered why Jesus after 3 years said, oh, it's enough. It's enough. I don't like here. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I feel Jesus told the Father, child, the place is wild. The people are wild. The people are too wild. Hey, what type of people are these? Wickedness, hatred, envy, sorrow, betrayal, hurt, offenses, pain, sadness. Jesus told the Father, look, it's okay. I've been here as a carpenter for some time before I started this one. And 3 years is enough. I've shared them. I've given them thy word. I've finished the work that I've done. You are 33 years in, you finished your work. I've finished my work that I've done. I would like to go. Oh, yes. And he knew that human beings were so ungrateful that they would kill him. And we just have to allow them to manifest. And they would do bad things to him. And they did it. It's wild. It's wild. It says the last enemy to be destroyed will be death. All right? Now, Paul said by verse 32, if after the manner of beasts I fought with men at Ephesus, what advantageth me it me if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. You see, he's saying that if after, put another version please, if after the manner of beasts, if from human motives, beasts at Ephesus, what does this profit me? If the dead are not raised, then the best advice would be, let us eat, let us drink, let's do anything you want us to do, and tomorrow we'll die, and that will be the end of it. When Princess Diana died, I sat with a man at Novotel, a white man, and I asked him, do you believe in God? Because everybody was so affected by she had died that day, and the night before. And I was waiting for somebody there. I asked him, he said, yeah, you know, I've been thinking myself whether there is a God. Because of Princess Diana. He said, he asked, it's like, are we just meat? When you die, the meat is dead. I said, no, there is more. And I started to witness to him. Oh, yes. I said, what is the point in all this Christianity if there is no resurrection? It is in the resurrection that you will see the benefit of all that you have ever done. You know, whenever somebody dies, everybody who related with the person starts to wonder, should I have done this? Should I have done this? And we start to regret in relation to anybody who is dead. It has happened on a number of occasions. I've seen it. Always the same thing. When you die, you will also have those feelings. Should I have done this? I should have done this. I should have done this. Should I maybe have done this? And that's why I want to encourage all of us. It's all about the resurrection. For me, I'm serving the Lord. My mind is on eternity. That's why you will notice I don't do many things for people to see. It is only because of recent times, so much social media, that people get to know some of the things we are doing. We've been doing them for years. Oh, yes. But if it wasn't for that, you wouldn't know what we are doing. Most of the things we are doing. When I'm in the crusade in the north, you can't even imagine what it's like to be in Bunkurugu. Or what it's like to be in Tiriponi. Or what it's like to be in Nakbanduri. You can't even imagine what it's like to be in Gusegu. Gusegu. Oh, yes. You can't even imagine. Different things. But There's nobody important there to do something for somebody to see and praise you and say, oh, well done, well done, well done. It is in eternity. It is in the resurrection that you say, yes, I should have done this. I should have done two more of this. I should have done more of this. I didn't take it seriously. It's when eternity strikes, then you realize, oh man, that was the main thing. That was the main thing. So Paul said, you know, what is the point of all these things I'm doing if there's no resurrection? But if there's resurrection, there's a point. If there's a resurrection, there's a point. So live your life with the mind that there is a resurrection. Amen. Amen. And then verse 33 says, don't be deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Don't follow these things. Awake to righteousness and sin not. Verse 34. For some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. So don't set aside your focus on eternity. If you ask me, one of the main things that strikes me more and more is eternity and the resurrection. That's what guides me to do what things that I'm doing. Why would I be here in the First Love Church? Why would I be doing a crusade? What else am I going to get? Why would I be launching a book? Well, I don't need to launch any more books. I've already written over 100 books and so had sold over 40 million of them all over the world. I don't need to be an author anymore. My authorship has exceeded many, many limits already. Oh, yes. What is the point? It's not for people. It's for eternity. Does it matter in eternity? Derek Prince said he believes the reason why Paul had such an influence and authority in the church, even up till today, is because he wrote so much. That is why, even up till today, Paul's authority and influence in the church is so strong. Even like now, I'm preaching from Paul's letter. It's because of his writings. So our books are very important. That's why Satan would always attack the books or the word. When Satan attacks you, his first attack is the word. Has God said? Is it God? Is it God? Always questioning the books and the word. So let us be focused on eternity. Oh, yes. Now, just as we go, to understand this eternity and resurrection in just one little way. It says in verse 42, so is the resurrection of the dead. He gives three ways you are going to die, which unfortunately reveal a certain condition which affects all of us in different ways. It says, number one, when you die, you are sown in corruption. Your body goes down, and when your body is down, you are corrupt, something that is false. Number two, it is sown in weakness. Look at verse 3, the next verse. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. Hallelujah. And the next one is, it is sown in dishonor. And it is raised in glory. So there are three characteristics of someone who goes into the grave. But the good news is that it does not end in the grave. When you die and you go into the grave, you are going in three ways. Weakness. Oh, yes. Number two, corruption. And number three, dishonor. How many would agree that if you were to be dead now and you were put into the grave, something weak is going down, something that has been weak? Oh, this side are mostly angels. I think I'm going to move to this side now. Yeah. How many realize that you are quite weak? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. What does it mean? There's weakness in the church. That is why we do not cast away somebody who is weak. Did you hear me? You don't cast away somebody who is weak. Then, and that's why you will never be cast out of the church. And that's why people come into the church and say, is this person also here? Oh, yes. Say, we are here, we are here. Then it is sown in corruption. Corruption means irreversibly spoiled. You see, when meat is corrupted, you can't reverse it, but you can freeze it. So it stays at how it is. But corruption is not something you can spoil. So some of our spoilings, you know, they are quite irreversible. Oh, yes. Yes. You see, when you've tasted certain things, they spoil you. That's why sometimes they'll say, oh, this girl is spoiled. Yeah. Like something has been taken away from innocence is gone. Oh, yes. Touch the person next to you. You know what I mean. You know what I mean. Corruption. Yes. That is why certain people don't have certain problems, because they have not been affected by certain things before. But what you must realize is that every one of us, especially the older you get, you see that there's corruption in you. Something that they have spoiled. That are not working. Oh, yes. And there is weakness. How many have been weak when you saw temptation? You said, please take over my life. The same temptation, oh, the one you confessed and you went and did it again. I've been confessing, you're saying, you know that this thing I'm confessing, I'll do it again. As you are confessing, Lord, forgive me, Jesus' name. And then dishonor. How many have done disgraceful things before? Disgracefulness on this side, mostly are on the left side here. What about the right side? Upstairs too, they are full of disgrace. Wow. But that is what we are. But the Bible says that you go down like that. And it is your body that is like that. Your body is like that. How many have been jealous before? Disgraceful jealousy. Somebody is having a wedding and you are not happy. You are saying in your head, he's going to find out that she's not really beautiful. Is it a nice thing to be thinking as the bride is coming down? You are thinking to yourself, she's going to find out that she's not very beautiful. Skin pain. Painful skin. Amazing. Jealousy. Horrible envy. But when you come out from the resurrection and we meet in heaven, I mean, you'll be filled with beauty. You'll be glorious. Your weakness will be gone. Your spoiling. Remember how you got spoiled from a slight homosexuality touch? It has changed you. Oh, yes. It has changed you. It's changed you. You've become different. That's not how you were born. Certain sexual things you've done, it's changed you. How many have been changed? On this side, mostly on this side. How many realize you've been changed? I don't want to ask this that there are dignified people here, so I'm asking mostly this side. Corrupted. You've been changed. But when you come out, can you imagine you'll be in heaven? You see a lady who is also come from the resurrection, and your lusts, at first you used to see again, anything that is wearing a skirt, it disturbs you. Instead of being gripped with lust, you'll be filled with normal love, just a normal Christian, and you even be able to tell her, Charlie, let's go to the house, and you go home together and spend the night together without any weakness. Wow. How many are looking forward for to this resurrection? Resurrection without problems. Oh, yes. Maranatha. Amen. And you know, this means a lot. In Romans chapter 15 and verse 1, what does the Bible say? It says, we then that are strong, we ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. So it means that all throughout our lives, we have to put up with the weakness of fellow Christians. And that is why, that's what a family is. I put up with your weakness and you put up with my weakness. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. You know, when Hitler came on the scene, he decided to kill all mentally ill patients, cripples, anybody with a problem, he decided to just eliminate them. You see, that is not what we do. We don't eliminate you because you are weak. When you are weak, we rather find, go abroad and you see, if you are blind, they'll find something for you. If you are deaf, they find a way. If you are mentally handicapped, they find a way. In a strong and a good nation, they have a way to support people that have problems. You don't throw them away. We don't throw family members away. No one's child is so bad that he must be fed to the lions. Oh, yes. So, rather the great mistake is to walk away in rebellion. To understand that we are a family. We have corruption. We know. Tell your neighbor, I'm aware of all the things you are saying. I'm aware. Number two, we have weakness. Yes. Look at me standing here. My son is dead. Look at it. As if I don't pray. As if there's no God. As if God is angry with me for something. I just came from my crusade. Yes. I mean, look, I'm standing here in weakness. Oh, yes. It's something. As if God doesn't answer prayers. As if God couldn't have mercy. Yes. That's our life here. Yeah. That's the life here. Till we go out of this world. There's weakness. There's dishonor. There's corruption. But we are still together. We are still a family. And we are still pressing on until we come to glory. To heaven, to his presence. Amen. And we must remember that. Never let Satan deceive you to put a hook in your mouth and pull you out of your family for any foolish reason. The Bible says, bad communications corrupts good morals. Be strong in the Lord. We are on the way to heaven. That's where we are. We are going all the way to the end of the way. Yes. There will be things we wouldn't understand. Things that we wouldn't want it to be that way. But I'm telling you, when a person is buried, these are the three things, no matter who he is. He's buried in weakness. He's buried in his corruptions. That the things that are spoiled about him. And he's buried in dishonor. The things that were disgraceful or dishonored about him. But it doesn't mean we are not part. We are all part and we are all together to the very end of the journey that God has given all of us. I hope you are listening very carefully. Yes. So let us stand with a mind for eternity. Just have that mind. I'm working towards the resurrection. This is resurrection, son. Jesus rose from the dead. Otherwise, he would not have tamely subjected himself to this death. He would have said, I'll stay here. When Pilate said, you know what Pilate told him? Pilate told him, do you know that I have power to release you? He told Pilate, let me tell you something, in case you don't know. If it was not given to you from above, you will have no power over me. In other words, what he was saying was that unless God has not decided, this crisis will not be going on. This crisis will never be on. As you are standing here threatening me. Oh. Except God, look at the scripture. It said, thou couldest have no power against me except it was given to you from above. In other words, this crisis will not be there. Could not maintain, could not continue unless it is given from above. That's why I'm standing here. You are threatening me. You are going to kill me and all that. It is from above. That's why I'm coolly standing here. I'm not struggling with it. I'm not struggling with it. You say you are like, there's nothing you can do or not do. So then I say, oh, if I have done this, if I do this, if I do this, there's nothing to do. If it was not given from above, it will not be there. It will not be happening. You will not be able to even look at me and say, do you know I can release you? Do you know I can help you? Do you know I can do something? You can do nothing. This crisis will not be there if it was not given from above. That's why I'm not fighting it. I'm not struggling with it. That's what Jesus was saying. I'm not struggling with this. I'm not struggling with you threatening me. Threatening me about my life. That I'll kill you. I'll let you go. I'll do this. This will happen. No. Don't think so. Except it was given from above. We will not be standing here. We will not be having this situation. Jesus was not moved by the crisis that was leading even to his death. It was nothing to him. He said, it is God who has given it from above. That's why it's going on. People cannot believe also the mysteries of God. But I tell you, ultimately, whatever enemy there is in your life, no matter what it's called, even the last enemy, death, is overcome in this Resurrection Sunday. The event of Resurrection Sunday. And that's why he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58, at the end of that chapter, he says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. Okay, because of all these resurrection realities, be steady. Be what? Steadfast. Steadfast is a naval term. Ability to be going and to go off course and to come back on course. That's the difference between steadfast and immovable. Steadfast is like you would have gone up, but you can come back. Clap for the prodigal son. He came back. I'm proud of the prodigal son. He came back. Unmovable. That was therefore. This chapter 15 is a resurrection chapter of the Bible. Somebody asks you, what is 1 Corinthians 15 about? It's all from verse 1 to the end. 58 verses about resurrection. Be steady. Be unmovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. Knowing this, that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah. This is the final verse of conclusion. After talking about resurrection, we always end in this verse. Therefore, my brethren, based on all that I've said, that resurrection is very important, this and that, we are sown in weakness, we come up. Therefore, because of all that I've said and all that is true, be ye steadfast and movable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. May your labor never be in vain in the Lord. Whatever you do in the Lord, it's not in vain. So that's what also God tells me today. I should be steadfast. I should be unmovable. I should always abound in the work of the Lord. And I should know that my labor is not in vain. Amen. In the Lord. May you work towards the resurrection, and may your eyes stay steadily on eternity. And as you keep your eyes on the prize of the resurrection and the prize of eternity, The Lord strengthen you to fight, to do his will, and to serve him with joy. Every standing with your hands lifted up. Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for raising us up again, encouraging us to serve you and to do well in the ministry. We are grateful. Thank you for everyone that is gathered here today. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. And everybody said amen. Amen. As every head is bowed and every eye closed, if you are here today, you want to give your life to Jesus, pastor, pray with me. I want to give my life to God. Maybe somebody invited you to church today. If you are here like that, you want to give your life to the Lord. If you are here like that, maybe you just live for this earth, but today God is saying, live for eternity. If you are not born again, when you are raised from the dead, you go straight into hell. And that's serious. That's serious. If you are here and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, lift your right hand. I'm going to pray with you. Yes, just lift it up high. Pastor, God, pray with me. I want to give my life to the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Maybe somebody invited you. Today is Easter. Somebody invited you. Want to give your life to Jesus. Father, thank you for all those that have lifted their hands. If you've lifted your hand, you want to give your life to the Lord. You want to be born again. You want me to pray with you. Come quickly to the front. Come from wherever you are. Come and stand right here with your hand lifted up. Come quickly. I want to just pray with you. I'm giving you 1 minute to just come all the way. God bless you. Jesus. His grace will be your covering. His blood will flow freely. It will provide your healing. Come running to that mercy seat. Oh, he said that I could come.
You want to give your life to Jesus? Sunday. This is your chance to be born again. Lift your hands and say this prayer with me. Say, Jesus, please forgive me for my sins. I give my life to you. I am sorry for all my sins. Wash me with the blood of Jesus. Thank you for saving me today. Please write my name. Please write my name in the book of life from today. Say, from today, I am born again and I am a child of God. Thank you, Lord, for saving me today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right.